Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa.
Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa.
Homage to the blessed, noble, and perfectly enlightened one. Namo saranto sucedo ye holahuri sammyao samputoshi.
Namo saranto sucedo ye holahuri sammyao samputoshi.
Wushang shen shen wei miao fa bai qian wan jie nan zao yu. Wo jin jian wan de shou chi yuan jie ru lai zhen shi yi. The unsurpassed, deep, profound, subtle, wonderful Dharma in hundreds of thousands of millions of eons is difficult to encounter. Now that I've come to receive and hold it within my sight and hearing, I vow to fathom the thus come one's true and actual meaning. Venerable Master and Dharma friends, welcome to our sutra lecture tonight. This is the 16th of August. It's a Saturday night. We're here in Berkeley, California. We're looking into the Flower Garland Sutra, the chapter called the Ten Grounds Chapter, and we are on the sixth ground. That's where we've come in our investigation of this text. So we start in a traditional way, which is we invoke the Buddhas, the Bodhisattvas, the beings who support and explain this text, that those words are on the front cover here. So we're going to chant Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yin Jing Hua Yin Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa 7 times. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yin Jing Hua Yin Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa Na Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yin Jing Hua Yin Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa Na Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yin Jing Hua Yin Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa Na Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yin Jing Hua Yin Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yin Jing Hua Yin Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yin Jing Hua Yin Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa Please turn in your text to page 4 and page 5. We're down at the very bottom, the last stanza. We're webcasting tonight. There's a group of Dharma friends out in what used to be called cyberspace who are listening in, and we welcome those folks. And this lecture will be available on our YouTube channel known as Dharma Realm Live. It's Dharma Realm taped, but who cares? That sounds like an exciting sutra lecture. By golly, how we're spending our Saturday night. So welcome to those folks, and we'll just jump right in. Could you put your palms together if you would, please? And let's take a look and see what the sutra is going to show us tonight. I'll give you a line in the Chinese, and you give it back to me. And this is a verse, so we're singing them. Here we go. Yi jin fan nao ru zhu chan. Yi jin fan nao ru zhu chan. Shan da xing kong fen bie fa. Ju zu zhi li nang bo ji. Mie chu zhong e cheng da shi. Mie chu zhong e cheng da shi. Over to the right, let's read together in unison. We ready? Starting with having ended. Here we go. Having ended all afflictions, one can enter every samadhi. Good at understanding the emptiness of the Dharma nature, one discerns all dharmas. Full of the power of wisdom, one can save all beings. Dispelling the many evils, one is called the Great Knight. Word by word, 已尽烦恼入诸禅, already put an end to troubles. What kind of troubles? Mind troubles, troubles in mind. Those are over for this bodhisattva because he's put an end to troubles in his mind. He can ru zhu chan, enter all dhyana states of meditation. Word for word, we're not going to interpret it. We're just going to look at the words first. So this person, he, she, get rid of the pronoun one. One is a bland, non-committal pronoun. They're flesh and blood people here. He, she. He has already ended the blues. No troubles in his mind. So when he meditates, he is able to master all the different kinds of meditation states. Line two, move right along. Shan da xing kong fen bie fa, really good at. Da here means getting at, getting, just he gets it. He is good at getting xing kong, nature empty, the empty nature of all things. Good at reaching through the empty nature of things that he meets and sees. Fen bie fa, further, he is good at funbia, cutting up and dividing dharmas, which here could be translated as phenomena, stuff, states, things, both physical and mental things. He's good at that. Good at two things, at understanding how the nature of things is empty, has no concrete substance, and he is good at discriminating between the different kinds of phenomena. Okay? So far so good. Word by word, we're going through. Line three. 具足智力能薄济, replete and full wisdom strength, able to broadly, extensively rescue. What does that mean? 具足, the compound, two words together make one English word, and it means full, full in, full of, 智, wisdom, strength. Full of wisdom, strength, 能薄济, he can help a lot. He can help all kinds of people. She can help all kinds of people. Ji is to save, to rescue. He is good at coming up with the best way to pull people out of their misery. All right? Full of wisdom, strength, able to save extensive numbers of people. Line number 4, 灭除中恶成大事, wipes out many evil things. 成 called 大事, great big 事, translated over here as night. We don't have, well, we do. What do we call them? Superheroes. That's what a 大事 is. It's a superhero. We call him a superhero. We got him. Everything from Marvel's Avengers to The Incredibles. Remember the Pixar film The Incredibles about the middle-aged family of superheroes? The guy with his belly couldn't quite get into his costume anymore, and the kids are child superheroes. So that's 大事. We used to translate this as a knight, but a knight, immediately we think King Arthur. We go in the West. We go back to medieval knights jousting on horses with scarves given to them by a fair lady who they will avenge with sword or lance. And yeah, that's the knight, but it's way more than that. A 大事 is somebody who is also strong in goodness, strong in wisdom. All right. Gets rid of many evils, called superhero. All right. What in the world are we talking about? We're talking about a bodhisattva. By the way, I should mention, we're going to end at 9 tonight, not at 9:30 as usual, just to let people know. So we often go to 9:30, mostly. Tonight, because of tomorrow's travel schedule, we need a little more sleep than that, a little more rest, so we'll end at 9 tonight. All right, 4 lines we just read, the stanza, we're talking about a bodhisattva. This sutra gives us a classical description. This is a textbook. What's a bodhisattva? This is a bodhisattva. Bodhisattvas come in different levels of skill, different levels of accomplishment, just like graduate students come at different levels. If you're, for example, my graduate program took 3 different stages. One stage was classes. One stage was exams. One stage was dissertation. All different. You needed to master every one before you made it through to the graduation. Bodhisattvas are the same way. They have different stages, many, many different stages. We're on stage number 6 out of 10, called the 10 grounds. This is the 6th ground. And this bodhisattva, at this point, has got these special qualities. What are they? No afflictions, good meditation. No afflictions, good meditation. 已尽烦恼入诸禅. What does no afflictions mean? No afflictions means she's figured out her mind, his mind. Something comes up. In the past, it would confuse you. Doesn't confuse you anymore. You see through it. You get it right away. Stuff that's close to you, your sibling, your brother, your sister, behaves in a way that you can't explain. In the past, it would make you angry. In the past, it would cause you to raise your voice. Now, because you've jin, you put an end to your afflictions, your sibling, somebody you've known your whole life, does something you can't explain, and what do you say? You say, oh man, let's go take a walk. And you take a walk in silence, and your sibling just blurts out what's behind the behavior, because they trust you. But something came up in their mind that they couldn't find room for, and it forced them to behave in a way that didn't make sense. And because you don't take it personally, because you don't react, because you don't judge, but instead you go walk with them, which says support on the side, out it comes. And sure enough, the behavior was a result of having that on the mind of your sibling who couldn't figure it out, but was able to express it. And sure enough, it's just that. It's all, oh, hey, that's great. Oh, you're a good brother. You're a good sister. Sure glad we took a walk, right? That's no affliction. Had you, when the behavior comes up, you couldn't explain, if you'd reacted, if you had said, you know, hard words, raised your voice, walked away, it would be, not only would that person, your brother or sister, still be holding that affliction, trouble, but now, because of your reaction, you would have split. Hard feeling. So often, it's just simply patience that gets through the knot, that unties the knot, and refusing to let affliction rise. What is the affliction? Greed, anger, stupidity, pride, doubt. Those are called the five basics, right? Greed, anger, delusion or stupidity, arrogance, or its opposite, low self-esteem, and then doubt, an approach of mind that's always indecisive. Even when you know it's what's right, you still hedge. That's doubt. You don't have those now. As a result, situation comes up. What are you like now? You're like a mirror. Comes in front of it, reflected perfectly. Gone, the mirror's quiet. 时来在静,时必在静. That's the Chinese phrase. Something shows up, it's reflected perfectly clearly. Something goes, the mirror's quiet. Right? That's Ru Zhu Chan, the ability to master every meditation state. What are the chans? That's a word I want everybody to look at. That last word in the first line, Yi Jin Fan Nao Ru Zhu Chan, right? The chan there. That word in Japanese is pronounced what?
Zen no shimasu. Hai, sou desu ne, kore wa.
Zen. Chan in Chinese. And the Chinese is the translation of dhyana. So that's a three-language word. And for sure, we've owned it. That's an American word at this point. The Zen of. We've adopted Zen. And I'm tracking that word every time I see it in print. How do people use it? It's really interesting what our culture thinks Zen means. Because we borrowed that word to mean a whole variety of interesting states of mind. There's one meaning of Zen that just means weird. You know, that's a Zen moment, you know. There's another meaning of Zen, which means somehow bringing mastery and special knowledge, the Zen of golf, right? You will be able to play golf better than anyone with a certain kind of, like you have one antenna up that no one else is, beep, 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 beep. The Zen of golf. Another meaning of Zen is just mysterious. There's a perfume. Shiseido has a Zen perfume. and you smell that perfume and you think, something mysterious and wonderful, you know. And there's another meaning of Zen, which indicates kind of wisdom. That some, you know, it's usually some old guy, usually with a beard, not very often a woman, interestingly. And you think, Zen, you know, real wisdom. So we've got weird. We have mastery with special information from some other planet somewhere. We've got mystery, you know, inexplicable mystery. And we have something that's kind of close to a little closer, which is actual wisdom that that sees clearly but is owned by somebody, the Zen master. So all these words, and so I watch, and it'll pop up in the New York Times. We're parsing the word Zen, the Zen of, all right? So what that means is, where do we first see it? We saw it first from the beatniks in the 50s, mostly because Gary Snyder, who lived in Berkeley, over here on Milvia. Gary was about a mile from here, and he and Allen Ginsberg and Philip Whalen and a few other of the beatniks, Gregory Corso and others, had encountered a translation of the Diamond Sutra, an early translation of the Diamond Sutra. And of course, Gary Snyder had actually been to Japan and had encountered Zen. And so in the writings of the beatniks, which was the precursors of the hippies, right? The beatnik generation had already found Zen in Japan, Japanese Zen, which at that time meant mostly meditation. Gary Snyder had lived at Shokokuji, I believe, which is a Rinzai tradition monastery, and he had had an actual experience of Zen, of meditation. And so they brought it over. And through their writings, we first heard the word Zen. And I remember my very, very, very first encounter with Buddhism that I know of in this life was in junior high school in Toledo. My father, on his nightstand, had a copy of The Dharma Bums, Kerouac's book. The Dharma Bums, and there was the word Dharma in the cover, the title, The Dharma Bums. And I remember I had a not such a wholesome habit of stealing the books off my father's nightstand during the day and reading them. Whatever he was reading, I was interested in, I would read them, and slip them back at night so he wouldn't notice they'd been gone. So I would steal books from my dad, and I remember taking The Dharma Bums to my junior high art class, trying to read it, and didn't make a lot of sense out of it. But those words popped out at me, Diamond Sutra. Kerouac wrote about the Diamond Sutra, and I thought, Diamond Sutra. There we go, Sutra, and Sanskrit, and Dharma, you know. And I remember Kensho was in there, Satori was the word. And Satori is the Japanese translation of Jue, which means enlightenment. So here are these words that are kind of little gems, little pearls dropped in there. And I don't know if Zen caught my eye, but clearly this was where you go to find anything about Buddhism in the 60s, or the writings of the beatniks. They were the first kind of ambassadors to go to Japan and bring it back. So why is that true? Why wasn't there Mahayana bhikshus and bhikshunis talking about prajna paramita, talking about taking refuge and the precepts and the wholesome dharmas of Samantabhadra Bodhisattva, like bowing and praising? Because after 1949, the bamboo curtain fell down and there were no Chinese monks, as far as the world was concerned. After Mao, the Republican government off the mainland to China, to Thailand, to Taiwan, no one saw or heard a Chinese Buddhist monk. Our teacher had gone to Hong Kong, and that was where you went if you wanted to find it. But after 1949, Buddhism in China, Chan, not Zen, Chan, officially didn't exist as far as contact with the West. So we did hear about Zen. So it's a historical accident that people know about Zen but not Chan, right? Because Zen is the Japanese pronunciation of Chan. These Zen monks went to China from about 900 on regularly and studied Chan, like Dogen Zenji in the 11th century, 12th century, went to China, learned Chan, took it back to Japan and called it Zen.
Zazen wo shimasu.
And Zen is the Japanese pronunciation of this word Chan. So people go, oh, what are you? Are you a Zen monk? And I go, not really. I'm a Chan monk. Well, what's that? Chan. You're a Chan monk? No. Chan monk. Well, what's that? They say, well, it's Chinese Zen. They go, oh, I got it, right? Which is backwards, historically backwards. Then if they're interested, if you really want to put the effort in, you can say what the Japanese got was Japanese Chan. And so the Japanese are the children of Chinese Chan. And they go, never heard of it. You know? And then if you really want to confuse them, you say, but Chan is Chinese Dhyana. They go, oh, okay. That's three languages. I'm out of here. I just like to meditate. Don't confuse me with all this stuff. So what's it going to be in America? Is it Dhyana? Is it Chan? Is it Zen? I think Zen is here to stay, honestly. I think we've already got it in our dictionaries. We've got it in our spell checkers. We've got it in our correctors, our autocorrect. So Zen is probably by now an American word. It's an English word. So I think that's, chances are, if you want to talk about Buddhism, especially meditation, then the word Zen is probably it. Right? People agree? Right? Marion, do you say you go to the, what, when people ask you what kind of Buddhism, what do you say? You don't use Zen. Okay. Sometimes you have to because people don't know. Okay, now, I would, as Exhibit A, there is a place down in Sunnyvale called the Sunnyvale Zen Center. What do they teach? Chinese Chan from Master Weijie, right? Zhongtai Chan Si in Taiwan, when you get to America, becomes Zen. Why? Because Americans know Zen. If it was the Sunnyvale Chan Center, people would go, Chan? You chant a lot? What's Chan? You know, Charlie Chan? What's that? They don't know. It's a Zen Center. Oh, Zen Center, meditation, I like that. Chan? No. So that's tactically a probably pretty good thing to do. But if you tell a Chinese Buddhist that we're advertising you as Japanese, frown, you know, I don't think so. Yeah. Roberto. Okay. It's not enough. It's alien. Alien. And you were mostly Southern California, right? So East Bay, you're Northern California, East Bay. Okay. Okay. All right. Yeah. Okay. So Roberto is testifying that he has been around the Buddhist world. And not only Buddhist, but other spiritual world, didn't encounter it. It was alien. My experience was through books. that I encountered Zen first. And then I'm a Midwesterner, transplanted to California. And in Ann Arbor, there was a Zen center in Ann Arbor, Michigan, which is 20 miles from Toledo, 23 miles. Korean Zen. Okay? And in Korea, what's it called? You ready to be confused further? Who knows? Choge. That's a division of Son. Right? The Koreans don't say Chan. The Koreans don't say Zen. The Koreans don't say Dhyana. The Koreans say Son. There you go. How about that? So, Zen in Ann Arbor was Korean Zen. Songsan Suni. So, where I was studying at a small university, we encountered sutras and books, largely the beatniks, but I had the benefit of Professor Thomas Fitzsimmons, bless his heart. He was poet in residence at the small Midwestern school where I attended. And Tom Fitzsimmons was a beat poet. He had been to San Francisco. He had been to Greenwich Village and had paid his dues, had a beard, wore a beret, tucked a cigarette on lip, like that. Played the bongo drums, you know. Was a crackerjack poet, excellent poet, and actually lived a Zen-style life. So Tom Fitzsimmons is a major influence in my life as a student. He was cool. He was genuinely cool, the way truly cool. He was hip before hip was invented. And he told me, I said, I'm going to Taiwan in 1969, I said, to learn Chinese with Oberlin College. Oberlin College had a summer program in Taiwan to learn Mandarin, going to where? Donghai Da Xue, 1969. So I signed up, I was accepted, and I told Professor Fitzsimmons I was going to China. And he said, going to Taiwan. I said, yeah, is there any, like, Buddhism in Taiwan? He said, oh, I'm sure there is, but I'll tell you what, if you want to find the real stuff, go to Kyoto. He said, I'll introduce you around. First person you want to talk to, Gary Snyder. I said, is he in Kyoto? He said, no, he's in San Francisco. I had to check his latest letters. So he said, you go sleep. He's on Bush Street. So I wrote a letter and made an appointment with Gary Snyder, climbed up to the second floor on Bush Street. Gary said, okay, here it is. Copied it out. What I'm doing is I'm checking my files, my Rolodex, right? They all had Rolodexes. So. Okay, here it is. Go see Irmgard Schlegel. Irmgard Schlegel is in Daitokuji. He said, you can't go to Daitokuji. You speak Japanese? I said, no. He said, okay, don't go to Daitokuji, but go see Irmgard. She'll tell you which monastery in Kyoto is accepting white guys, round eyes. Not everyone will accept foreigners. So I said, great, thank you so much. And he gave me the address. Then he said, this is off the topic, but he told me something also very interesting, which proved to be very valuable advice. He said, how are you getting back from Japan? And I said, I don't have any plans yet. He said, here's what you do. He said, if you want to come back with money in your pocket, he said, when it's time to leave, go to the merchant seaman, the union office. And if they need an American to fill a position on a ship, you got a job. Come back as a merchant mariner. And instead of paying money to have the airplane fly, you'll come back with a salary. He said, if you really play it right, you can get your union card. I said, oh, in my eyes, 19-year-old kid from Toledo, So every bit of advice that Gary Snyder gave me was spot on. And I got to Kyoto after the summer at Middlebury, at Donghai University. Sure enough, Irmgard Schlegel said, no, she said, I don't think Ryo Anji is taking anybody. Let me call. She calls Ryo Anji. They don't want any Westerners. They don't trust them. Too much trouble, right? So she said, but you know who's the fallback is? Antaiji. Uchiyama has got a very big heart. She said, you go see Uchiyama Roshi and he'll take you in. So it's like, oh boy. And Ngbar Schlegel came back to become the head of Buddhist Association of Great Britain, the London Buddhist Society, and later went to Antaiji, and sure enough, the master there said, he looked at me and said, he said, Nihongo wa dou? Ii desu ka? Nihongo dekimasu ka? I don't speak any Japanese. He said, shake. Like that. Shook hands. Come on. He said, like that. That was it. So I lived as a Zen novice in Japan. Zen. Soto Zen. And what you do there is called shikan taza, jiguan dazo. All you do is pay attention to your sitting. They say, it's all you have to do. This stems from the teachings of Dogen. Dao Yuan Chan Shi, Dogen Zenji. Dogen, his dharma came in a very uniquely Japanese way, which is able to take an essence of something. The Japanese have this genius for distilling it down to the essence and holding on to that. So for Dogen, he said the posture was extremely important. So you had to do it. Your thumbs have to be just like this, you know, and you have to sit totally straight like that. And the posture itself is Buddha. Chiguan dazo, shikan taza. Pay attention only to your sitting. And have no further thoughts. While you're sitting, Zen is there. Okay, so that was it. Very simple and yet difficult. They had a practice at Antaiji of 5 hours of meditation a day. 3 in the morning, 2 at night. 3 in the morning, 2 at night. You want to live there? You do 5 hours of sitting a day. 3 hours in the morning, 2 at night. And that's pretty much it. And vegetarian meals until it was time to go out and beg for beef for the sukiyaki and for the whiskey, Suntory whiskey, special begging. That was begging. You got, oh, put money in my bowl because we're going to buy some beef for the sukiyaki. Not quite, you know. So anyway, real meditation, that was my first encounter with Zen. Not Chan, but removed, taken from Chan. So, Roberto, that's all an answer to saying, I encountered it early. You know, it was Zen, but only because my college roommate, when I was there in Kyoto, had finished his degree one year early, came to San Francisco and met Master Shuenhua. When I came to Berkeley, he said, he called up, hey, you got to come over and meet the abbot. And bit by bit, I made my way through the door of Gold Mountain Monastery to meet Sherfu. And I realized that what I'd been studying was Japanese Chan. It wasn't Chinese Zen. So, okay, are you all clear on that? Much not, no. Japanese Dhyana Son. Yeah. What's it going to be in America? What are we going to do with it? We'll see. We'll see. All right. So, Yi Jin Fan Nao Ru Zhu Chan. Where does Chan come from? What is Chan? Chan is the Chinese pronunciation of the word Dhyana. In Chinese, sometimes it's Chan No. Two syllables. Chan No. Dhyana. And it refers to two kinds of things. One is a series of 4 stages of calming the body and mind. They're numbered. First, second, third, and fourth stage of dhyana concentration, of chan meditation. Each one is marked by a physical change. Your heartbeat stops in one, your lungs stop breathing in the other, your breath comes in a different way, your coarse thinking stops in the third one, and your subtle, all movements of the mind stops in the fourth stage. It's a progressive, clarification and purification of body and mind. And it comes from sitting still. Sitting still. Sherpa would always say, Master Hua would always say, anybody can enter the dhyanas. And they're states that we don't get from outside, which is so interesting. It's that these are pre-programmed. They're hardwired in us, these chan states. And another important thing to know about them is they are related to happiness, joy, bliss, and a state where bliss comes to an end. You transcend bliss. Can you imagine what's out there behind happiness, joy, and bliss? That's the name of them. How about that? So when you can, when we can, concentrate body and mind, why? Yi jin ban nao. No troubles left. No greed, no anger, no delusion, no pride, no doubt. No movement in the mind. And you, ru, says enter. I think it doesn't mean enter. I think it means master. When you master all the stages of dhyana, there is a corresponding state of joy, of happiness there. How about that? You understand? So meditation, in other words, leads to happiness and joy. That's what the instruction manual that this book is promises. Should we run through them? When was the last time we ran through the list? They're fun to know because you remember people who have come here regularly. Remember we were talking in the last and the fifth stage. We were talking about the correspondence between traditional education and what we call the humanities now. What's an educated person? What does an educated person know? That's a question. If you ask somebody in the Buddha's time, they would say, Wu Ming Xue, the five bright, the five illuminated sciences, the five disciplines that lead to light, you could say. And among those is knowledge of the dhyanas. What does an educated person know? How to put your body and mind into a state of stillness and purity and concentration. You're supposed to know that. Okay? How about that? That's interesting, isn't it? This, in other words, this is common knowledge. What happens when you meditate deeply? That's, you're supposed to know that. What do we have now? What's the counterpart? We have them for sure. For example, maybe you're an athlete and you're a long-distance runner and you know about the zone, right? Long-distance runners know about the zone. You run until you kind of get to this state where you're gliding, you're almost out of your body in a way, and the mind changes gears. If you don't drive a car with a stick shift, you don't know about this. But if you drive with a stick shift, the old manual transmission, the engine goes, you put in the clutch, move the lever, like that. You shift gears. Manual transmission. When you run long distance, your body goes, and the engine shifts, so to speak. When runners describe the state, they talk about hitting the wall. Long-distance cyclers talk about it. Long-distance swimmers talk about this. You get to a place where the body gives you feedback that you can't go on anymore. And if you just keep on going, you shift gears and you're through the wall. It's a different state, right? You've heard about this, right? And anybody who uses their body and mind to a place where they have to call on other reserves to continue, it's not just pushing through, that's a state. if you don't run, if you don't bicycle long distance, if you don't swim long distance, maybe this is kind of a, you know, somebody else's state. What other physical states do we have where you transcend a limit and keep on going? And I know one of my uncles, it would be eating turkey at Thanksgiving, right? You keep on going and your stomach expands to a state you ordinarily can't reach, you know. More dressing, more gravy, more mashed potatoes, more pumpkin pie. You know? What kind of states do we have where you go beyond your limits? Playing music. Time disappears. In fact, we know somebody in our community who does that, who can play beyond where the mind seems to go beyond the music. Yeah. So, Jay, what else? You're about to say. Seems like it disappears, but to you, it does. That's this, you know. So, something that requires concentration. Concert pianists have to memorize their program. They don't play with music, sometimes 30 minutes long, 40 minutes long. How is that possible? You know. But they go beyond a limit. What else? What other states do we have? In, you know, where, and I'm saying in the things like mastery of a knowledge that is considered, is it far out? Yeah, it's not ordinary, it's not normal, but you can study it. In the Buddhist time, knowledge of the dhyanas was considered knowledge you needed. Okay, here's a simple one. Here's a simple one. Driving a car. Driving a car. Driving, the ability to drive a car, common knowledge, right? Not possessed by an elite few. It's not privileged. You're 16. Is it 16 in California? Okay, Toledo, Ohio, 16. 16 years old, you go to, you know, driving school, you take driver's ed in high school, you get out there, you go in the car with the driving instructor and teach you how to parallel park and teaches you the laws and how to signal, let the person on the right go first at an intersection, you know, you learn the rules, you have to operate the car, and for the beginning driver, this is big stuff because your new synapses are being forged. You're learning a skill that you're going to keep going for 30, 40, 50, 60 years sometimes, 70 years. So when you can drive, you don't think about it. You don't pay close attention to how you're turning the wheel. You just turn the wheel, right? There's an example. The dhyanas are like that. They're in there waiting to be operated. Dhyana number one, Li Sheng Xi Le Di. The Xi Le, the happiness stage, the stage of happiness, Li Sheng, beyond what ordinary people know. The state of happiness beyond what ordinary people know. So in your daily rounds, what makes you happy? Food, sleep, physical pleasure, okay? Some people would say a cup of coffee, you know, latte, perfectly done latte, barista latte, right? Makes me happy, okay? So all the things that ordinary people are happy about, when you enter the dhyanas, first dhyana, you go way beyond any physical pleasure. Now, I won't speak from experience, it's not my experience, but Master Hua would say, this dhyana, the state of dhyana, if you can meditate to that place, there's no flavor like it in any other physical experience that you can imagine, okay? Number two, so that's Xi Le, that's happiness. The second one is Ding Sheng Xi Le Di, the state of happiness where Ding arises, where Samadhi arises. It's that, they say, from the point of view of the second dhyana, the first dhyana is really crude. It's really kind of coarse. When you get to the second dhyana, Samadhi arises, and what was now becomes It's another octave. It goes from here. To here. Ding sheng, right? It's a refinement. It's another octave of shi le, of happiness. Master Hua says there's no happiness on the second and the first dhyana that can compare to that second dhyana. So, are you all interested in it so far? You know, think about what kind of happiness do I know? Right? Okay, third dhyana. Li shi miao le di. The stage of miao le. Miao le. Wonderful bliss that leaves happiness behind. So what would that be like, right? Okay, I got one. You ready? If this is the first dhyana, and here's the second dhyana, here's the third dhyana. Another octave up, the harmonic of it, right? Sounds nice, pure. Okay, well, what would that be like? There are corresponding changes in the body with each of these dhyanas. Each of these stages of meditation, the heartbeat stops. Of course, everybody goes, no, you're dead, right? Not. Circulation changes. Second dhyana, your lungs stop. And somebody goes, now you're really dead. Nope, not. Say that your skin pores breathe. You do horizontal breathing. And why? You're really quiet. You're really, really quiet now. You're just sitting still. Okay, in the third dhyana, it's a further refinement because you're heading to, what happens in the third dhyana is coarse thoughts stop. And they don't stop like cut off. They get integrated because there's something more subtle and systemic. There's something more integrated happening with your body, your mouth, and your mind. So those raw thoughts that are emotion, instinct, intuition, you know, impression, it all goes harmonized into a wave. The fourth dhyana is called shi nian qing jing di, the state of purity that leaves all thoughts behind whatsoever. So subtle thoughts stop in the fourth dhyana. And it's, Master Hua says, at that point, even talking about bliss, there's no you there to experience bliss. There's no difference between bliss and you and all other states. So bliss is just too coarse at that point. So you go from the state of happiness that no other experience can know. Number one, you go to the state of happiness where samadhi arises. Number two, you go to the state of bliss beyond happiness. Number three, and you go to the state of purity where all thought stops entirely. Now, are you a robot? No, not the way it's described. At that point, it's not that thoughts don't happen any more than sights stop. It's that the mind comes back into the other five senses. Think of the commentary there. Right now, we use our minds overmuch. Our minds are like these computers that we pay too much attention to, so they're called false thinkers. We false think. We produce too many discriminating thoughts. We take them as real and we get confused. Meanwhile, we don't have false sights, false sounds. The eye sees movement pretty accurately. The ears hear sound pretty accurately. The mind doesn't think thoughts very accurately because the sixth consciousness that records thoughts receives all the others together. And there's karma coming up and karma going away. All these things are going on. When you get to the fourth dhyana, the mind only thinks genuine thoughts the way the eye only sees genuine sights. It only functions correctly. Thought, object of mind. It doesn't double think. It doesn't think and react and judge and plan and anticipate and then react and then, you know, like that. It doesn't echo with thoughts the way normal thoughts. We only have first thoughts. There's no second, third, fourth thoughts in that fourth dhyana. So you're not a robot, but your mind joins the network of the other five. You true shrink, head shrinking, right, in the best way. So how about that? The Buddha, on the night of his enlightenment, entered the third dhyana, they say. The Buddha went to Buddhahood. The prince went to Buddhahood from the third dhyana. So how powerful are these states? And yet, Sherpa would say, anybody can. Anybody can enter them. It's just, do you want to do it? Okay, how about that? How do you get to that first dhyana? Desire has to be very calm. If desire is still attaching to stuff, every time the nose smells a scent you like and smells one you hate, you're out of dhyana because your mind is not quiet. If the ear hears sounds you love and sounds you hate, pops you right back into consciousness. Dhyana is this harmonizing of all states. Everything, they say, becomes kind of ordinary. Before, it's love, hate, love, hate, love, hate. When you meditate to this state, it's kind of like this. And you feel very, very happy. Very happy indeed. So that's the dhyanas. Okay, questions about that? Jay? Yes. Yeah. In the progression of dhyanas, can you lose it and go back? You definitely can. The dhyanas are not the stages of arhatship. People confuse those because there's the first, second, and third, fourth stage of arhats. When you get to the state of arhat, the arhat states, those samadhis of the that arhats know, those are actual nirvanas. But they're progressively up to the Buddha's. The fourth stage arhat is nirvana without remainder. Okay. The dhyanas are not that. They're different. Interesting, huh? So When you get to this point in your study of Buddhism, at least in the Mahayana tradition, suddenly all these connections arise. Let me give you one. The gods that live in the Brahma heaven, okay, with a quick tour of the heavens, right? There's the six desire heavens, there's the 28 Brahma heavens, and there's the four what are called heavens of no return. Okay, so gods live in all those levels of heaven. When you get to that second one, what are called the Brahma heaven gods, they are always in one of or the other of these states of dhyana. What makes them Brahma heaven gods? They're always meditating. They're always in dhyana. They're always in chan. So as a result, their desires are very thin. It's not, they don't need a lot. You know, they're okay in themselves because they have this joy, bliss, happiness in body and mind that who wants to leave it? You don't. So their bodies are very pure. They live a long time. They travel around. They interact with humans, you know, the gods of the Brahma heavens. But it's a state of true joy, true happiness. And when you, once you see this kind of roadmap, then you touch the sutras. Oh, so dhyana. When the next Buddha to be is just about ready to become a Buddha and they have seven lifetimes remaining, three lifetimes, one lifetime remaining, they live in the Brahma heavens, waiting for their karma to come around so they can be born in their last lifetime as the Buddha. So arhats live in the dhyana realms. Brahma realms, I'm sorry, the Brahma heaven. How about that? Interesting, huh? And somebody could say, well, that's a nice story. That's the best story I've heard tonight, you know. And the Buddha would say, nothing story about it. This is called a handbook. This is how your mind works, only nobody researches it. Nobody does it long enough to get there. Anyone can, most people don't. We're too busy doing what? Going out our senses, picking up objects, choosing among them, loving this, hating this. But when we can truly meditate with character, so precepts, and then have concentration, that state of harmony, body and mind, can happen. Doesn't come from anybody else. It can come from you. So, okay, that's one half of what I wanted to say about Ru Ju Chan, entering the dhyanas. The dhyanas are a form of samadhi. So Chan Ding is one kind of San Mei. In Chinese, the word Ding is used for both dhyana samadhi and other samadhis. And when we get to the other samadhis, the Chinese translators used both words, San Mei, the sound, samadhi, and Ding, translation of concentration. The other samadhis are specific states of meditation, each one having a specific name. For example, the Sharangama Samadhi. People know our Sharangama Mantra, Sharangama Sutra. Those all come from one kind of meditative trance. What would it be like? Here's a super mundane example. Are we eating Italian tonight? Okay, you can expect, you know, pasta. You can expect marinara sauce. You can expect, you know, scampi or fettuccine or various kinds of cheeses, wines. We're eating Italian. Oh, we're not eating Italian. We're eating Mexican tonight. Okay, Mexican food comes out with all the wonderful, you know, tamales, tostadas, tortillas, burritos, all the wonderful things that we've grown to love about Mexican food. No, we're not eating. We're eating tonight. We're eating Chinese. You know, all that that means. So different cuisines bring with them different flavors, different spices, different approaches to nutrition. The samadhis are the same. The Sharangama Samadhi is a way to meditate that brings into it these experiences, these abilities, this knowledge. Okay? So there are specific meditations that lead to specific results. There's an Avatamsaka Samadhi. Right? There's the Dharma Realm Samadhi, etc. So, just to say, Yi Jin Fan Nao Ru Ju Chan. He's put an end. She's put an end to all troubles, and as a result, masters every kind of meditation. Okay? Now, pin it down. What happens when we meditate? Our legs hurt. We get bored. Too much stuff comes up and it just overwhelms us. We got to stand up and run away because there's too much static on the radio. Right? It's a very real struggle with the body, a struggle with the mind. I watched this happen with my college students in Australia. These were very normal, very typical mainstream American and Aussie kids, 20 and 21 years old, who sat still in my class for first 5 minutes. 5 minutes was really hard for a lot of them. And it continued to be hard for like 3 weeks. And then we increased it to 10 minutes. And I had him keep a journal to write about what was going on. And of the 33 of them, about, I would say 7 of them had an experience of something changing sufficiently that they wanted to continue. The other 20-some, it's like, I'm not very good at this. Meditation doesn't work so well after 6 beers. I meditated down at the beach, and the sand was really wet, and I got bitten by a crab, and I stopped. I meditated on a bench out in the field, and I got rained on, and it wasn't any fun at all, you know. I was meditating a lot, but then I got news from back home that my father had died, and so I like quit, you know. But then another student had a similar heartbreaking experience and wrote, "It was the meditation that allowed me to get through this without going crazy." You know, so 1 out of every 6 students like took this basic introduction where we sat there. You know, I did 4 or 5 different kinds of meditation, and 1 out of 6 went, "This is really good. I like this." Something happened that I was finally able to sit still without all the noise going on inside. You know? So, how interesting, right? That's, I think, pretty normal. A lot of us get to the body, stop. Hurts, confusing, too much static, waste of time, boring. We're so stimulated by our devices, you know, that we can't not have that input. So how can I sit still when I might be like getting a message, you know? What about dhyana samadhi? What about happiness beyond the knowledge of all other living beings? It's like, it didn't go anywhere. It's just we didn't do it. It's all in there waiting. Yeah. Interesting, huh? So, this bodhisattva, and swap the pronoun. We're on page 4 and 5. Check page 4 and 5. Down at the bottom. Having ended all afflictions, one can. Good at understanding the emptiness, one discerns. Full of the power of wisdom, one can save all beings. Dispelling the many evils, one is called. He. Tom. You know, Mary. Put a flesh and blood in there. It's talking about you and me and people. When afflictions are over, meditation is right there. The door to meditation opens as affliction decreases. See that relationship. It's, you can enter every samadhi after you gradually end all afflictions. Good at understanding the emptiness of the Dharma nature, he discerns all dharmas. Oh boy, oh boy. Try to explain this one. What it's talking about is she, the bodhisattva at this point, sees the world around her with real insight now. What before was something to buy or to sell or something to acquire or accumulate or something to get rid of, the bodhisattva now, because of his or her wisdom, looks at it and you could say sees through it. Understands that it's just a component thing. Comes together of pieces and it's going to come apart because of pieces. The bodhisattva now looks at the nature of things and says what? Ku kung wu wo wu chang. Every component thing, everything made of conditions is cool. Unsatisfying, because you can't get it. Kong, empty, meaning can't find a soul to it. Wuwa is not self. There's no self in it. Wuchang, and it passes away. That's the bodhisattva's x-ray vision now. Stuff is different for this bodhisattva. They don't see things the way they used to. What was it before? Oh, that's family car. I've had so many adventures in that car. How could we sell it? Or, you know, that's my spouse. I'm so tired of him. You know, he still doesn't brush his teeth and he snores at night like crazy and he wants me to wash his underwear and, you know, I'm tired of this. Like, what do I, you know? Why? Because we don't have wisdom. We don't see through it. See, this is my soulmate, the person I married. That's the bodhisattva who's going to cross me over by teaching me patience with his snoring and his underwear, and, you know. So the bodhisattva now has wisdom that goes through the externals to the heart of it. And what do they discover? They discover nothing lasts. Nothing lasts except nirvana and empty space. Two, things don't satisfy, right? They are cool. They're suffering, but it's not suffering. It's that they don't hit the spot. Nothing hits the spot. When it gets in there, you discover what you wanted has moved on. Right? Three, you can't find anything ultimate. No identity in that carnation that makes it entirely carnation. It's hydrocarbons. It's in season. It's pink now, but it'll be that soon, right? And further, no self. I can't identify with it anywhere. Not me, okay? Ku kong wu wo wu chang. All conditioned dharmas have those four aspects. The bodhisattva sees it, stuff is different now. Good at understanding the emptiness of the dharma nature. All phenomena are that way. When I say that, what am I saying? We're borrowing the Buddha's eyes. We're looking at the world through the Buddha's vision. Is that the way I see stuff? No. I still have things I love, things I don't like, you know. I still have expectations and hopes and all. So it's not empty for me. The bodhisattva sees through the surface to where the true essence of this is revealed, which is nothing there to grab onto. Don't attach. As much as we attach, that's how much we'll suffer when its nature is revealed, which is doesn't last. Nothing lasts, except what? Kindness, compassion, karma itself, living beings, they're always creating karma and coming back. He discerns all dharmas, their nature. If you see that, what do? They would say the arhat leaves. I'm out of here, it's all empty. The bodhisattva says, because it's all empty and they don't know it, I got to stick around to wake them up. Because people hurt because of this. Because of lack of insight in the nature of things, we grab on and it hurts. The bodhisattva says, yeah, it's empty, I got to stick around. So in the midst of this nothing to be obtained, the bodhisattva, because of compassion, stays there to teach. So this is where we see the heart of the bodhisattva. Full of the power of wisdom, one can save all beings. Because he sees that, and further, the bodhisattva is good at explaining it, he can wake people up. Dispelling the many evils, he is called superhero. He is called not an avenger, he's called a superhero, the great knight, Da Shi, is called the great knight. Many other names too, but that's one of the names of a bodhisattva, right? Great knight. Let's sing about one of the great knights. Can you turn, please, to page 28? We got one. We have a story. Talk about stories of great knights. The story of Erstor Bodhisattva is coming up. You know, summer seems to have gone so fast. People are, you know, school is starting up at Dharmaram Buddhist University. And we're heading towards autumn. And also, when we get to autumn, we get to, not quite there, We get to the 15th day of the 7th lunar month. And the 15th day of the 7th lunar month in Chinese culture is the day the ghosts come out. The hell is open and the ghosts appear. Chinese culture and wherever Chinese culture went affirms that the full moon of the 7th lunar month is the day. And so Erstor Bodhisattva is this heroic being who could leave, but instead he made it his business to rescue beings, to go down to where the suffering is the most intense, the hells, to save the lives, to bring beings out. Now, the stories around this bodhisattva are wonderful, including the fact that he was a she. The stories that talk about Erstor Bodhisattva's past, he was a woman. The sutra gives us stories from the creation of Erstor Bodhisattva. Erstor was a woman. And the stories go on in great detail about the heroism. So the Da Shi, in the case of Erstor Bodhisattva, was a woman, right? So how interesting is that, right? What kind of strength is required to go down to the hells to save your mother after she has fallen there because of her greed, anger, and delusion? This bodhisattva continues the relationship after she dies. Past the grave, the bodhisattva, in this case, continues to think of her mother. Didn't forget her. That's heroic. We'll boost it up. Change the pitch. Easier to sing. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva, King of Great Mountains. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva, King of Great Mountains. You're welcome to sing along. To end her mother's misery was her quest. To end her mother's misery was her quest. Her vow she professed, a filial child so blessed. To end her mother's misery was her quest. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva, King of Great Mountains. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva, King of Great Mountains. See if you can see a superhero. He makes his home deep in the hells. He makes his home deep in the hells. Well, it's deep in the hell that this bodhisattva dwells. He makes his home deep in the hell. I return, I rely on the bodhisattva, King of Great Vows. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva, King of Great Vows. He shakes his staff and makes the suffering end. He shakes his staff and makes the suffering end. And then living beings' karma starts the whole thing up again after he shakes his staff and the suffering ends. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva King of Great Vows. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva King of Great Vows. Until the hells are empty, he won't rest. Until the hells are empty, he won't rest. Saving those who transgressed is the thing that he does best. When the hells are empty, he won't rest. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva King of Great Vows. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva King of Great Vows. The fires of the hells won't make him move. The fires of the hells won't make him move. So firm are his vows, he'll stay there to improve. The fires of the hells won't make him move. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva King of Great Vows. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva King of Great Vows. It's best to practice patience when you're stressed. It's best to practice patience when you're stressed. King Yama's unimpressed with your screams of protest. It's best to practice patience when you're stressed. Okay, last time, here we go. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva King of Great Vows. I return, I rely on the Bodhisattva King of Great Vows. So that's Erstor Bodhisattva, a true superhero, a genuine superhero. Please turn over to page 6 and 7. This is coming up next week, and it's the summary of the praises by the devas who are about to hear the sixth ground dharma. And Muna Liberation Bodhisattva here asks for the teaching. Please teach us about the sixth ground, the sixth stage. So that's coming up next week. I am going to be away next week. I'll be in Toledo. We have a funeral. And I'll be with my family, and particularly my sister Liz, and staying there for a little bit. So I won't see you next week, but we will have the sutra explained by Dharma Masters from CTTB, so please do come and enjoy. And we're going to dip into this sixth ground Dharma, which has to do with, what, the 12 links of conditioned arising called pratitya samutpada, which is some people would say the Buddha's most outstanding insight to neuroscience and to metaphysical reality as it applies to our bodies. Why do we come into birth and death? How do we leave birth and death? The Buddha saw it and explained it in 12 steps. That's what it's about. That's what the rest of our chapter is about. Very powerful insight, deep, deep, deep seeing into what's going on right this minute in my body, right this minute in your body and mine, how one perception links to the next one, pulls it forward, and how to break them so they stop. It's all in this Dharma. So this is really, 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 really important stuff. And it's also hard to understand. Confess, hard to understand. But we'll work on it. We'll get there. I think maybe by November, we'll all understand it. We'll be ready to break the links. So it's going to take a bit, but if you stick with us, I think we have a chance at understanding what the Buddha wanted us to get about the 12 links of conditioned arising. Pratitya Samutpada, conditioned arising. Okay, it's time to transfer the merit now, and let's do so. Think of some place in the world that needs our attention and our concentrated focus, our merit, and send it out to that place. Wherever you want to transfer your merit, do it right now, please. We'll see you in 2 weeks, and also the folks who are joining us online, we appreciate your telling friends about this webcast and get some interest going in our sutra lecture. Here we go. The last page in your songbook. Said our teacher. If it's the Tao, advance. If it's not the Tao, retreat from it. Pick out what's good that you heard and cultivate it. Pick out what's not so good that you heard and change it inside. See you in a couple weeks. Please do come next week for the continuation of the sixth ground. Bow in respect to the Venerable Master. Namo Dafam Bo Hwa Yen Jin Hwa Yen Jin